reality talk shows. It's time to spread the word to friends, family, and the universe. 24 hours of music and talk radio without limits. That's why people keep coming back for more. That's ubnradio.com.
Hey, everybody. It is Wednesday, March the 9th. I'm Emerson Collins, and you're listening to The Dell and Emerson Show. Straight talk. Real gay! We have an exciting episode today. It is sponsored by Wolfe Video and the newly released independent horror comedy film, You're Killing Me, available now for download and rental from iTunes and Vimeo, and you can get the DVD at wolfvideo.com. And I'm super excited that we will be joined a little later by the two writers who are also the director and the star, Jim Hansen and Jeffery Self. But before we get to those brilliant and talented individuals, I want to welcome back, while Dell is out of town, Blake McIver.
Hello, Emerson Collins.
Hi, Blake. What's going on?
You know, just living the dream.
You had an exciting thing this week.
I did, yes. We talked about it last time I was on the show. I did a video for AIDS Healthcare Foundation for International Condom Day, promoting safer sex. And we did a parody of Justin Bieber's What Do You Mean? Called Wrap Up Your Love.
Yes, and where can people see it?
People can see it. You can find it on my Facebook page, Blake McIver Official. I've got it posted there.
All right, and I am super excited. My nearest and dearest and oldest friend, he's 147, stand-up comedian, paid regular at the Laugh Factory and the Comedy Store. He tours with everyone from Heather McDonald to he just returning from a little Georgia tour with Julie Goldman on the People's Couch with me, Justin Martindale.
Yay!
Well, hello! It's so exciting. Finally have you on the show.
I know.
He's so busy. He's never been able to do the show before. And I was like, oh, we can. We have it. How was Georgia?
Georgia was great. Julie and I had a great time. We actually raised some money in Atlanta for Atlanta Pride. That's coming up in October. We also drank a lot of moonshine and got possessed by Civil War ghosts.
Hashtag Pride.
And yeah, hashtag Pride. It was a lot of fun.
Also, you went to one of my favorite establishments in all of Atlanta.
I did.
What is it?
Crystal Burger. No, I went to a wonderful family establishment called Swingin' Richards.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, Swingin' Dicks.
Yeah, and it was not really a family establishment.
Family in the archaic, like, hey, Mary, are you family way.
It was a lot of nude, naked men's.
Was your Southern Belle inside?
Oh,
all
you know
the
it was. I was just like, I declare, here's $5. Like,
yes.
I cannot believe this. Here's 20. Let's get a lap dance.
For those of you not familiar with Swinging Richards, it is an establishment for gentlemen who happen to like gentlemen and bachelorette parties, probably.
Well, and they took us all out there. Yeah, it was them being hospitable, like Southern people
do. Just friendly.
Right, right. Yeah.
And it is a strip club, and they have to keep one article of clothing on, so it's Swinging Richards. They keep on their shoes.
Their shoes, yes.
So, just Swinging Richards.
Yep.
I love that. Well, let's give Del Shores a call so we can say hey to him, and then we can get on through the news. Del Shores!
Hey, how are y'all?
Good, how you doing?
Hey, Del.
I'm just about 5 minutes from Swinging Richards.
Oh, Lord.
Amazing.
Yeah, my name's on the wall, Del, so you gotta go get a Sharpie.
I'm trying to find Leslie Jordan, and I'm figuring he's in one of those rooms back there.
Yeah, he probably is. Just throwing coffee at people.
So, yeah, I'm in Atlanta right now, and just hanging out with my friend Matt for a couple of days. We had a little investor cocktail party last night, and that went really well for a very sordid wedding, and getting so close to the green light of the movie, as you know, Emerson.
Yes!
And then I'm headed back to Florida to do final three shows there. I'll be in Tampa on a Friday night at the Cuban Club. I'll be at Hunter's and Wilton Manors on Saturday night. And then wrapping up in Fort Myers with at the Laboratory Theater of Florida. Great, great theater there at 8 p.m. on Sunday night. And then back home.
And if people want to find tickets to all of those shows, they go to?
They just go to my Facebook and push events. And I'm very organized, very organized. Mm-hmm. All the links are there, and you can, get your tickets and come see me. And I've been having such great shows down in Florida, so very excited about that. And I'm so glad that y'all are having Jeffery Self and Jim Hansen on the show today. I have not seen You're Killing Me yet, but I'm going to after watching that trailer.
It's I watched it last night. It was fantastic, yeah. So I'm super excited to talk to them
about
it.
It's really, really a fun movie.
Well, I'm not going to keep y'all anymore because you have a lot to do.
Yes.
And thank you guys. And thanks, Justin and Blake, for
holding
it down and keeping Emerson in tow.
Oh, you know? Someone has to.
All right, have fun.
All right.
Take care. Have a good show, Zell.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, Del. Have fun.
Bye.
All right. Well, kicking off our equality update, we talked last week about Indonesia banning effeminate behaviors from television. Well, China has just outright banned gay people from television at all.
Oh, no.
Their new moral guidelines come out shortly after they stopped Addicted, a web series based off the popular boys' love novel, Are You Addicted?, which featured male teens kissing. So the new policy bans abnormal sexual relationships and sexual behavior, as well as witchcraft practices and feudal superstition and grotesque criminal cases. So...
But what about all those girls that love the boys' love?
Oh, no.
No, no. When they get drowned at birth.
Oh.
Yeah. The love
oh.
that dare not speak yeah. its name.
Yeah.
Or be seen on television. I like that they put gay sex along with witchcraft.
Oh, they should.
And grotesque criminal cases.
Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah.
So no straight stabbings and no gay kisses.
Well, I guess they can't watch Charmed either over there. You
like
know?
A trifecta.
No, you can't watch Buffy. Salem or Buffy. Nothing.
I mean, all those witches. True Blood.
All you get is two broke girls. That's it.
That's it.
That's all you get.
No, but they're
the Big Bang Theory.
Yeah, but there they change it to two broke boys.
Well, yeah, and then it's banned.
Then it's about you and me.
I know, right? And then we're just us living our truth.
Our mask for mask hetero truth.
Yeah.
Two broke boys.
It's two broke
in China.
No, two broke bros. Let's do that.
Two broke bros. Broke bros.
And we're just like, hey, what's up?
Yeah. Yo, you got a dollar?
I guess.
Okay.
Let's go to Swingin' Richards.
So, good job, China.
Yay, way to go, China.
Definitely no gay people there. I love this story, and Blake, I feel like you will too. The U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, Samantha Power, took the Russian ambassador and envoys from Australia, Vietnam, Namibia, Norway, Mexico, Uruguay, Gabon to see the great American lesbian musical on Broadway, Fun Home.
Yes.
She hoped that seeing a positive lesbian character might open a few minds, and in a Q&A session, she said to the cast, "Thank you for bringing this all home in a way that resolutions and statements never can." Oh, I love that.
That's great. Get them to the Broadway theater. That She's will like, change their minds.
Hey, Russia, come see lesbians sing.
And I bet you they all ran out and bought key rings. After
and they all, yeah, and they got Indigo Girl CDs and
Ring
just, yeah.
of Keys.
Melissa Etheridge on repeat.
It's like in the United Nations VIP gift bags. It's just uh-huh. like a ring,
ring of keys.
Hermes keys.
A
ring
with
keys.
A little Fun Home keychain on
them. Yes, absolutely. Aww. It's just the little house.
Amazing.
We saw it while we were in New York yes. for the doing publicity for the People's Couch, uh-huh. and I like cried
it's spectacular.
Like a little baby.
Yeah.
Just sobbed. Yeah. Just sobbed. That Rachel Maddow looking one was brilliant.
Beth Malone.
Beth is so brilliant, but I was literally like, you need to play Rachel Maddow's sister in something, right?
Rachel Maddow the musical. No,
of course
oh.
not.
Tell her that.
Great show. You should play Rachel Maddow.
Great
she could,
show.
She could do the Rachel Maddow story.
Probably, yeah.
She's,
yeah.
she's spectacular.
It was a really great show, but I love that her solution, you know, here they are at the United Nations talking about the equal rights of LGBT people around the world, and she said, come see a show about real people. Let's take mm-hmm. this off of words on the page
yep.
and come experience yeah. it as told through art.
Well, now they need to take Kim Jong-un and take him to go see Wicked. That would be great.
Perfect.
Uh-huh.
So, no, but then he'll think he can defy gravity, and we don't
well,
need
that's,
that.
Well yeah. didn't you see, there's some photo of him with supposedly like a nuclear warhead or something that
sure.
looked like a disco ball?
No, that's just
oh,
his haircut.
Yeah.
That's
like,
his haircut, yeah.
But also, it was like, it looked like Shellacked. A disco ball. It was like a North Korea Studio 54.
Oh.
So?
You know,
let's get into
takes
that.
Takes all kinds.
All right, moving on. We have talked so much over the year and a half that we have been doing this show about Roy Moore and Alabama and their issues with marriage equality. Well, the Supreme Court of Alabama dismissed finally, a motion for clarification and reaffirmation of the court's orders upholding and enforcing Alabama's marriage laws. Basically, it took them 170 pages to say, yes, we have to do what the Supreme Court says.
I'm glad you they think? Can count to 170.
170 pages to say, do what everybody else is already doing.
Right. Uh-huh.
And, so but, ridiculous.
But in the pages, the justices on the Alabama Supreme Court definitely shared their opinions. Chief Bigot Roy Moore, I think that's his technical title
yes.
now, called the Obergefell Supreme Court Majority Justice as tyrants. Justice Tom Parker said, Obergefell conclusively demonstrates that the rule of law is dead. So great to have one judge saying about another judge's opinion. Justice Glenn Murdoch said, they cannot change the nature and reason of the thing called marriage. And finally, Justice Michael Boland basically said, the only reason we should not keep pushing forward on this is we can't afford another civil war where brothers are killing brothers.
Oh, geez.
Has it come to that? I mean,
I mean, it took them 170 pages.
To say, like, we don't want another civil war.
This decision from 9 months ago was like, well, maybe we don't want to have another civil war over this.
Jeez.
Alabama.
Get it together.
And this is the reason I put the story on, because this next story explains, because we can mock and laugh at these justices, but
right.
these are the leading legal
People.
Scholars
oh,
in
yeah,
the state
no.
of Alabama about the interpretation of law. And that kind of attitude permeates their society and leads to situations like this. Just over a month ago, a bisexual 19-year-old man, Nicholas Hawkins, was murdered. He was found shot and wrapped in a blanket, buried under brush and debris in a suburb, in a rural area northwest of Birmingham in Alabama. He was an aspiring cosmetologist who dropped out of high school after coming out as bisexual because of the bullying and was working on his GED. They have arrested 3 men in conjunction with the murder and 3 others with hindering the prosecution. But I feel like that's really important. It's not, they haven't set out the motive of why certainly this happened, but this is an openly bisexual kid in rural Alabama,
right,
in the same state where these justices are saying, begrudgingly, we will be dragged kicking and screaming to equality. Right.
And this is a kid, a 19-year-old, not kid, but like, this is a kid who was like, please, people are trying to kill me.
Yeah.
Like, he was like, please, these people will kill me. And unfortunately, they did.
Yeah. Well, and it's important because we don't often, you know, the bisexual part of our community often gets overlooked and dismissed. Mm-hmm. And so very specifically, not only was he was coming out in a part of the community that's often identified less. We see less representation in the media, less discussion, even though they're the largest part of our community.
It's just all that witchcraft we're practicing, you know?
Right. Yes.
I mean, I have
that's
gems and
it.
Stones and frogs in my pocket right now.
Frogs in your pocket?
Yeah, I do. I have a large toad.
Oh, that's what that is.
Yeah. Well, you can't go to China. Just so you know.
You know, I can because I can teleport.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm a witch.
Part of the
I'm
witchcraft.
A warlock. I can teleport. I'm in China right now.
You're so fancy.
I'll just stay home and watch
He's
Mulan.
Also wearing no pants. So, you know, we all make choices. And another in Alabama, once again, continuing the bigotry there. We told the story a couple of months ago of 2 women who were in a relationship, 2 lesbians, and they are now separated. They had 3 kids while they were together, but after the breakup, the birth mother denied her former partner visitation rights. The former partner moved to Georgia and got a ruling from the court there to allow her visitation, and then Alabama basically said that she did not have any rights as a parent. They dismissed the Georgia ruling. The Supreme Court finally has reversed Alabama's decision, saying a state may not disregard the judgment of a sister state because it disagrees with the reasoning underlying the judgment or deems it to be wrong on the merits. So this mother will finally get visitation with the daughter that she had, the kids that she had in that relationship.
Thank goodness.
But once again, Alabama.
Alabama.
Parenting and progress.
Follow the damn law.
I feel like the motto for Alabama should be like, get it together, Alabama.
Come
visit Alabama.
That was nice.
You should do jingles.
I really should do
and
a
radio.
Jingle.
Mm-hmm. And
but
also phone sex.
Again, I'm a witch, so it will have an underlying tone to it with subliminal messaging to get into the minds of
young
youth.
People.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Gayifying the youth of America.
Yeah, of course.
I loved you in The Witches of Eastwick.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, well, let's flash through the gay news. Kicking it off with the nonsense in politics, y'all, we're not going to stay here very long because it makes my brain bleed.
I know. Mm-hmm.
But it's really important to talk about the juvenile sexual innuendo that has been running rampant through the grand old party. Mitt Romney last week gave a giant speech saying that Donald Trump was basically the worst thing ever.
Mm-hmm.
And Trump came out afterwards for his clapback and talked about how he endorsed Mitt Romney when he was running and said the following. He was begging for my endorsement. I could have said, Mitt, drop to your knees. He would have dropped to his knees. He was begging.
This is just Republican porn. Like,
yeah.
I hear this statement and I just want to hear exactly. It's just so dumb. These people are stupid.
I know he was going for sort of begging, but like that is definitively also one homophobic because it's saying like, oh, gross that like a man would have to get on his knees and like be subservient to another. Like a lot of us like doing it.
I'm down on my knees. I want to take you there.
Are you going to sing that to Donald Trump? I want to take you there.
In the midnight hour.
Yes. I want to take
him in the midnight
straight
hour.
Into a witch chipper.
The witching hour.
The witching hour.
In the midnight hour.
Full circle.
You are a
sacrificial
witch.
Blood realness.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. And not to be outdone, of course, we've talked about the Marco Rubio little hands comment that he made at Donald Trump. And I'm sure you've seen and heard the clip, even if you didn't watch the GOP debate, where it happened, where Trump responded, because it's important to respond when people insult your penis size.
Sure,
apparently.
Sure. Especially when you're running for president.
Of course.
We definitely, I feel like it's very important to voters that we know the dick size of all of the potential
but
candidates.
Like in a no homo sort of way.
Yeah.
But also not in the like they better not say 8 inches like everyone on the internet.
No.
Like everyone do you notice that every gay man on the internet has an 8-inch
penis?
Everybody's
got an 8-incher.
Until they show up at your house.
And you're like, oh.
Be like, where did you measure from? The small of your back?
Yeah.
Your tramp stamp?
Right. Yeah. What is this? What did the
8 centimeters?
Did the groundhog see its shadow?
But Trump said, look at these hands. Are they small hands? And he referred to my hands. If they're small, something else must be small. I guarantee you there's no problem. I guarantee.
Okay.
You know the way I feel about this?
My hands
Let's ask
are
Melania.
Small, I know, but they're not yours, they are my own.
Also, because see, I just think if you have small hands, it makes it look bigger. Win-win.
How big are your hands?
They're average.
Yeah, Blake, let me see your
slender.
Hands.
What?
Uh-huh.
But like, these are my hands on the show. Oh, yes,
like,
we know.
Like
yes.
Alien zombie fingers.
I'm going to say it.
What?
Centaur penis. Here we are, ladies and gentlemen, Justin Martindale. Welcome to the show. For those of you can't see because he's sitting down, but Justin's 7 feet tall.
Oh, you can tell because I'm in a shot with him and I look like a hobbit.
No. Oh my gosh, we look like the Kardashians. It's like Courtney, Kim, and Chloe. Ladies and gentlemen, the gay view today brought to you as the Gaydashians.
Yep.
Oh, Lord.
All right, flashing on. Monday night, of course, in the premiere heard round the world, RuPaul's Drag Race finally returned to television.
I need a click. I need a click.
Yes.
Team Too Much, Death Drop, yes. I Live, Hot Tay.
All of them.
Jesus. All of them.
That was drag to red.
I was just living my Laganja Estranja life.
Whoa.
All of it at once.
Clearly.
Come on, what? Headphones.
What did we think?
Oh, my God.
How are we feeling? Season 8.
Come through, Season 8.
This is my March Madness. I do not care about the Super Bowl. I don't care about the halftime show. I want 14 queens to blood battle sport it out.
Yep. Yes.
For the crown. Yes. I think it's going to be a great season. Tons of drama the first episode.
Already.
I already have my picks.
Okay.
Oh, who are you supporting? Who are we feeling?
I'm going for Bob. I'm going for Kimchi. And I'm going for, what was the other one?
Oh, really important.
Robbie Turner.
Nice.
I love Robbie Turner.
Yes.
What did you think?
I loved it. I loved every second of it. I loved the challenge. I love that we got to revisit old challenges from before. It was so much fun.
I liked the idea of that more than the execution. Well, because when they're all doing things from different challenges, some challenges are harder than others.
Right.
And I feel like some are way easier to sort of slay on the runway than others because poor Naomi Smalls walking around with that boat. She was me. That was me living my life. They're like, carry a boat. And I'm like, I can barely lift the strap.
But Naomi Smalls is like head, neck, and legs. That's what's crazy.
I'm right here. I'm right here. You are right here.
Just a gay gazelle.
I will say that one thing that was very exciting is the queens in general are a little older than last season. I feel with some of the complaints last year about sort of a one-note area of knowledge, expertise, and life experience.
Sure.
Having some older queens, a greater variety of queens, it feels like we cast it really well to give us lots of diverse points of view, lots of age ranges.
Well, and some of the most fun for me with drag is the references to drag culture and the history. And so the fact that we have some queens that actually know their shit, like...
And also, I need him to be smart. Like, my personal drag preference is I need you to slay a lip sync, but I also need you to be able to host a show.
Thank you.
But you can't be dumber than a box of rocks and MC a drag show.
Well, like, some of them are fetuses, too. Some of them are like, I'm 20 from... I'm like, what?
Well, this time there's one that's 21, two. And there's a lot that are older.
Yeah, there's... I'm already done with some of them, though.
Cynthia Lee Fontaine, the Puerto Rican Texas girl, when she's like, I'm from Texas, y'all, is
I'm from
adorable.
Austin.
To me, she's like the Puerto Rican Jocelyn Fox a little bit. I love that category.
But stop trying to make my ookie ookie, or what was she trying to say?
No,
I'm here for it.
I'm here for this.
She's like Charo.
She's sweet.
All of the nonsense.
What do we think about Derek Barry?
Here's the thing. I'm really excited because Derek's in that category for me with Bianca and Courtney Act, people that are true, and Chad Michaels, people that are truly professionals.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really excited to see what Derek brings beyond Britney. You know, I love the Britney. She's my people.
That's what I'm saying. I know. I'm thinking, though, but what Chad and all those people you mentioned they did more than that. Chad wasn't just Cher the entire time. Like, I'm already like, if Derek makes it, it's a snatch game, I'm like, who's he going to play? Oh, wait.
Yeah, but that's the same way we felt about Chad. Like, you better do Cher.
Yeah, you
so
have to.
So he has to, in the coming weeks, definitely demonstrate more than Britney body performance responses
and
wigs.
He has to give me more.
Give me more.
Yeah,
but I did like that Rue said, no, we still want to see more of, you know, all of your Britney.
And it's okay to do what you do. Bianca Del Rio wore the same one-shoulder dress 18 times and won because she's a genius.
Well, and every challenge was an acting challenge and she could get herself
out
of that.
I don't need every queen to do everything.
Right.
I just need you to do several things better than everyone else.
That's what I'm really kind of hoping for this season is less acting challenges.
Why? It's television.
I don't want to see.
What do you want?
Because I don't want to see.
What do you want?
I'm telling you, what do I really, really want?
Uh-huh.
I want more lip syncing challenges. I like photos. I like you're gonna give. I want performance, but not. I don't need to see Chi Chi. What was her name? Cha Cha Devane or what? Chi Chi Devane.
Cynthia Lee Fontaine.
Sure. I don't need to see her reenacting Hamlet.
Have you watched the show? Because it's the same every season. They lip sync at the end of every episode.
I know that, but I'm saying like I don't need an acting challenge of like if they want to do like a John Waters tribute. Yeah, of course that was fun. But every what was like that Shakespeare in the Park episode? I'm like, what?
Oh,
why?
That was not necessary.
Why is this happening?
I don't know. I feel like there's something to be said for a challenge that no one can do because part of it is seeing what your personality does and something you definitely cannot do.
But I do like the I like if they give. give it a theme, if they give their runway walks a theme, I like that, keeping the tradition of that. Like, yes. Bring that in.
Yeah. Yes.
But I want more, like, performance.
I'm just excited because it feels like we're off to a grand start.
It's good. Yeah, it's going to be really, really good. Season.
There's some smart, shady queens. Yes. Also, yes. The funniest thing in the entire world, all of those winners there and that clown in the place of Bianca.
As Bianca Del Rio. Oh,
Bianca wasn't available, so we got a circus clown.
A clown.
Same thing.
A clown.
It was
the literal
grown clown.
The shade of it all.
Oh, it was
Where's
amazing.
Latrice?
All right, so we'll keep chatting about that through the season, but it's off to a great start. I guess my Disneyland, it's my favorite thing on the planet.
Yep.
Flashing on. Something that brought a big response from the LGBT community. Nancy Reagan died on Sunday
at the drag queens.
Age of 94. And it's interesting because there were actually pieces of her story I actually didn't know that much of because like when she was doing things, I was, you know, trying not to poop myself and like learn my letters. Mm. But a lot
of
people,
like 3 days ago.
Yeah. So it was like she was first lady exactly 6 months ago, I think. Uh-huh. But there was a big story. Chris Geidner, who works at BuzzFeed, is my Equality Update go-to reporter. And he did a great story months ago about the period when Rock Hudson was dying in 1984 and when he flew to Paris and his publicist's request to the White House that they help get Rock Hudson in to see a particular doctor in a military hospital in France, and that Nancy Reagan and one of her team members determined that they shouldn't do that because they shouldn't play personal favors on behalf of friends of theirs. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the LGBT community's response this weekend was understandably negative because many attribute the lack of response by the federal government to the early years of the AIDS crisis, mm-hmm. being that the president did not mention the phrase AIDS or HIV until 1987.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's as they should be pissed off.
But there were parts of the story I didn't know that she came up through like the big homos of Hollywood when he was when Ronald was an actor here and she got in with one of the big decorators that also decorated the White House. The first gay man to spend the night in the White House openly, I believe, was their decorator. That she had very close friends that were homosexuals but then ran away from that when it was politically expedient.
Well, I think it was terrifying for them because it was like this huge, massive epidemic that nobody really knew anything about at the time.
Yeah.
And again, yeah.
But there were a lot of years in between that, you know, where there was silence, where there need not.
Right.
Where it was already a serious crisis.
Yeah.
So
there's, we can't whitewash the past.
Well, and we've talked about it a number of times. It happened with Scalia. And it's interesting because it happens on both sides when someone that wasn't popular with either liberals or conservatives dies. And there's this call immediately for, you know, respecting the family, which certainly if you know any of those people, excuse me, and can speak to them directly, you should. But this idea of sort of deifying or washing away all of the sins of important historical figures in our culture immediately after their death, I think it does a disservice to their own legacy and memory to not talk about the good stuff and the complicated and the terrible that they did in our culture.
It's actually one of the things that I love about the internet right now is that people can't die and their like bad stuff can't die with them.
Right.
Like once you've said it, once you've tweeted it, once you it's there.
I know. When I die, Justin's going to be trying to stand up, give a eulogy talking about all the crap I pulled at Baylor.
And I will be copying it and retweeting it.
Also, he's on my permanent banned list for my funeral, just so you know. You're not allowed to speak.
Why?
But you can cry. You can cry at the
casket. Can I wear red to your funeral?
Well, yeah, because you're Latina by marriage.
Okay,
right?
Cool. Yeah.
So you can wail and weep by the casket.
I'll be like, hey,
you cannot
Dios
speak.
Mio.
You're not performing a stand-up comedy set at my funeral.
I will.
All right, flashing on. This story was just for Blake since he is here.
Yes.
If you have not seen The Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, I don't know
what are you
don't
doing
know
with
what
your
you are
life
missing from your life. And the breakout star of that show, available on Netflix, is Titus Burgess.
The
and
brilliant.
One of his big moments from season one of the show was a Pinot Noir song that you must have seen come across your Facebook
Pinot
feed. Exactly. Blake's recording the remix coming up. Well, Titus has released his own Pinot Noir wine because
oh my God,
he learned
Blake
anything from The Real Housewives. The way to set your life is to create a wine.
Right. We need to create a wine.
We, in the worst
can
way.
Can we just call it wine, but like spelled
W-H-I-N-E.
W-I-N-E.
Whining wine.
And
it's
like
kind of like Harry Potter.
But make it a competitor for $2 It's like $1.50. Like wine. Like wine. It's just the shill at the bottom of the barrels.
Yeah, it has like grape chunks in
like
it.
For that
sangria.
For that night, after when you spent the night in the gutter and in the morning you need something to take the hair off the dog, get you some wine.
Yeah, I need
to stop whining and get wine.
Wine, only available in Alabama.
You can get Pinot by Titus from the website, pinotbytitus.com. You click on the yes
to enter
the website.
Okay, I'm going to admit that I spent so much time just watching him because there's a video that pops up of him just pouring wine.
Yes.
And I definitely, and it just repeats on loop. I definitely spent like 2 minutes just like, watching Titus pour wine.
I just like the name Pinot by Titus.
Yes. Yes. It's made in Santa Barbara, and he announced the news via Instagram, a limited number of bottles, $24.99. So
I'm getting us some.
So
don't worry.
Get you some.
He's doing the Patti LaBelle sweet potato pie,
yes,
but with wine.
Yes.
Yeah.
But for Pinot Noir.
Awesome. Where's it? Oh my God, I'm excited.
And we're going to start our wine, $1.50.
Yeah, wine.
You can buy it, not actually at 7-Elevens, but just in those outside, sad little like newspaper kiosk thing out front.
You know where they make keys?
Yes.
Well, we need to make like a Cabernet Sauvignon. Yes, we need like...
Cabernet Sauvignon.
We need like a Pinot Grigio. I'm a little worried
that the studio Pinot Grigio, is so gay, it's just going to spontaneously combust.
Pinot Grigio...
Pinot Grigio, no girl.
Yeah, Pinot Grigio, no girl. Yeah.
Thank you guys. We'll be here all day. All right. Flashing on. In our Transcetera news, a really interesting story broke yesterday. Quite some time ago, Lana Wachowski came out as trans. She is a part of the duo that created, of course, the Matrix movies and V for Vendetta. And they created the new Netflix series that I love called Sense8, which features cultures from all around the world and also gender identity and sexuality from all around the world. Mm-hmm. They featured a number of pansexual sex scenes with lots of different combinations.
You mean episode 8?
Yes.
The orgy heard around the world.
Well, yesterday, her sister, Lily Wachowski, also came out as trans in an article that she wrote for the Windy City Times. And it was very interesting because she's smart and successful and said that she's definitely had support, obviously, and with her sister having come out before her. But she shared how the story happened, that the Daily Mail from the UK showed up at her front door, knocked, and said, "We're going to tell this story, basically, with or without you, so you need to sit down and give an interview for us." She basically said, "Screw you," and wrote out her story and gave it to the Windy City Times, the local LGBT paper. I love that element.
Good for her.
And because we're going to get to it, but because of the reasons a lot of people have been frustrated with Caitlyn Jenner, Lily, in her story, acknowledged her privilege, talked about that the most vulnerable are the women of color from the trans community, and that she knows that she's very fortunate to have the finances, the means, and the support system for her transition. And I just thought it was very articulate as well as acerbic as it should be for being basically dragged out of the closet by media.
Right? Yeah.
Absolutely.
So that was exciting, and I think Sense8 has one of the best portrayals of a trans character played by a trans actress where it's not about the transition. There have been elements of dealing with her unaccepting family, but it's not about the struggle of transition.
But she's also a lesbian, too.
She's living her life.
Yeah.
She has a lesbian girlfriend, Freema, who I love from Doctor Who.
Oh, yeah.
But so, really great. And two trans women telling that story.
Good for you.
But we cannot not talk about it, because this week, the season 2 of I Am Cait premiered. I'm sure many of you saw the interview that happened last week in The Advocate with Dawn Ennis, where she was asked about who, as a Republican, she supports for president. She said, "I like Ted Cruz. He's very conservative, a great constitutionalist, and a very articulate man. I haven't endorsed him or anything like that, but I think he's an evangelical Christian and probably one of the worst ones when it comes to trans issues." Now, the interviewer asked, "You're going to be Ted Cruz's trans ambassador." And she said, "Yes, trans ambassador to the president. So we can say, Ted, love what you're doing, but here's what's going on."
Here's what's going on, Caitlin. Yes. If Ted Cruz gets the presidency, there will be trans nothing. There will no be trans ambassador. There will be nothing. There will be no support for your community at all. At all.
But here's what I love, because the I Am Cait season 2 premiere that happened the other night, I watched, and Dr. Jenny Boylan, who I think is the hero of the show, and what I love about this show is that Caitlin has to be allowing this, and the producers are featuring her articulating things that are not correct socially, that many of us know about Republican philosophy, conservative philosophy, and we are seeing Dr. Jenny Boylan and Candace and Shandy shut her down with that is not the reality that the vast majority of the trans community experiences. Right. So I think people's frustration with Caitlyn is totally earned and appropriate, but I love that we're seeing the conversation happen between liberal members of our community and someone representing the conservative part of our community.
And also these women who have been in the trenches of the trans movement for decades.
I just think it doesn't need to be called I Am Cait. It should just be called Lost in Transition. Like, it's just, and honestly, I'm like, I love all of the other women on that show. I think Candace Kane needs her own show.
Yes.
She's fabulous.
Amen.
All of them. I'm so fascinated by them. But it's just, again, it was very uncomfortable watching everyone educating Caitlin.
But see, that's why I love it, because we watch reality shows and people fighting about things that don't matter, like name cards at a seating party on the Beverly Hills Housewives. Don't get me wrong, I love it. It's my life. But seeing this kind of argument on a reality
that
show
that actually matters.
Caitlin essentially is standing in for conservative family members, conservative friends. One in five people in the LGBT community identifies as conservative. And so to see that argument happening on television, you can be angry at her all you want, but I think watching that fight happen
sure.
is good important. And important.
But that's what I'm like, your party looks at you like a freak show. Like, that's what I'm baffled by.
And I hope that through the rest of the season, we continue to see them educate her.
Yeah.
Because they're educating her, but hopefully other viewers that are watching as well.
And I like that it's a road trip.
Yes.
Well, I'm learning, guys. That's
there
just
it
my
is.
Truth.
Okay.
All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break and let you guys watch the awesome trailer for You're Killing Me. And right after this, we will be back with two brilliantly talented and hysterical gentlemen, Jeffery Self and Jim Hansen, the writers and director and star of You're Killing Me. Woo-hoo! We'll be right back.
Hi guys, it's George.
And Barnes.
We just wanted to give a shout out to all our new subscribers, all our new fans.
We've got more Pam and Tabby coming out soon.
More Country Cuts.
More Denise and Susan. Don't forget to like us on Instagram, follow us on Twitter.
Oh, and add us on Facebook.
And thank you so much for watching. Subscribe.
You make those stupid videos.
I just saw the one about the woman who gets chopped up into pieces.
Is that a machete in your lab? Why, yes it is.
Oh, I like that one.
I just killed a guy last night for the first time.
Did you?
That thing that you want to do, do it to me.
So what, you're telling me, like, you're some lonely murderer who I'm giving my number to? Hot.
So he walked up to you while you were holding produce?
Yeah.
God, that kind of thing never happens to me.
Well, he has a really twisted sense of humor.
Can I call you tomorrow? I'm gonna have to ditch these bodies somewhere.
You're funny.
That's, like, scary.
Well, he's not scary. He's gorgeous.
Dr. Strauss would never believe this.
Who's Dr. Strauss?
He's the doctor at the hospital where I used to live.
But like a Pray the Gay Away?
It was more about learning empathy and self-awareness.
Oh, I'd be so into something like that. I go to yoga.
Joe's never brought a friend home for lunch before.
We just connected really quickly.
Should you be connecting?
Oh, we're not connecting. I mean, yet. Okay.
That was weird.
You have to be very nice to Joe today because he just killed his parents, so he's feeling very vulnerable.
Did I tell you guys about Andy?
Yeah, no one's seen him for a while.
That explains it, because I sent him a video and he hasn't even liked it.
You knew that he was killing people and you didn't even call the police.
I didn't know he was serious.
Your feelings really matter to me, and I want to protect that.
This is gonna sound crazy, but is this some kind of conspiracy? Like, is this a conspiracy that's happening?
Are you, where are you right now? We're calling 911.
And we are back. Genuinely, yay. I am thrilled to have these two gentlemen with us. They will make any of you feel like your life is slacking for the number of things and the amount that they manage to squeeze out of every day and every week. Hold on, let me just read the list for a minute. Director and co-writer Jim Hansen has done a few things that you might have seen in the LGBT community. The brilliant and viral Chloe video starring Drew Drogi they created together. He also has two hit web series, Paragon School for Girls and My Drunk Aunts. He's had a number of short films tear around the festival circuit. And on top of that, he's an accomplished and acclaimed costume designer and production designer on a whole bunch of TV shows that you absolutely have watched. Hello, Jim.
Hello, how are you?
Good. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
And not to be outdone, I need 700 breaths to even begin to tell you about our next guest. He is a writer, an actor, a comedian. He created and produced his own TV series for Logo, Jeffery and Cole Casserole. He's appeared on television shows from Desperate Housewives to Torchwood to Difficult People to 30 Rock, and he has written and produced for multiple seasons of Billy on the Street, and he has two books, because, you know, in your free time, when you're not acting or doing something, what you should do is write a book. Straight People, A Spotter's Guide to the Fascinating World of Heterosexuals, and 50 Shades of Gay, and currently available, upcoming, Drag Queen, a young adult novel that is coming out very soon, Jeffery Self!
Yay!
Literally, like, they make me feel like I do, like, one thing a week, right. And I'm thrilled with myself.
I need a nap, like, right now, after all those credits. Oh, well,
you exhaust me.
They're all made up, you know.
Well, I mean, that's great, except that they're all over the internet. Genuinely, I want to tell both of you, Blake and I watched the movie last night because I couldn't get into the instantly sold-out screenings that happened at Outfest where Justin saw the film.
I could.
So we watched it last night. It's available now on iTunes, Vimeo, both for rental and download, and yes. Of course the DVD from wolfvideo.com.
Amazon. Amazon too, right?
Amazon, uh-huh. Yeah.
And Wolf
literally everywhere. Yes. Wolfe is a great organization and done some great work.
Blockbuster.
Oh,
Farmers
in
Only.
Peace.
Yes. Yeah.
Rest in peace.
Video Hut.
Well, let's start at the beginning. So, horror comedy.
Yes.
What? The two of you wrote this together.
Yes. Yeah.
How is this process?
A lot of cocaine.
Uh-huh. Perfect. Seemed obvious.
Good.
I think we've done lots of things together in the past, and we're like, okay, let's just make a movie, because you know, like Justin is like in the same kind of group of friends as, and we all know all these creative people, and
you know, there are a lot of like gay people, and like they're not working.
What? Yeah.
We're totally busy. We're very busy.
So busy.
I'm like, shuffling papers.
Yeah. So we were like, yeah, we were just like, let's make a movie, and like because he's like, he knows how to like do everything. Like he's
literally,
like, literally, like is like he writes the movie and directs the movie, and then he like. Like edited it himself. He like wrote half of the score himself. He designed, you know, the costume. Everything. So right. So like I was like, well, yeah, we should definitely make a movie because then you're gonna do everything. And like
perfect.
And I just have to be in it.
Right.
And we did, and it was really really fun. And the process was we wrote it, outlined it, and then we broke it up into pieces, and then we sat down together after we had a draft and sort of worked on it.
Like kind of the thing that we've been saying a lot is that like it's a horror comedy, and he's like the romantic comedy guy. He loves all the, you know, First Wife Club movies.
Rom-coms,
That's not really a rom-com, but
I mean...
and then, you know, I will watch any horror movie that's on Netflix because it's like, you know, that's my go-to.
Uh-huh.
So we sort of decided instead of blending them together was to sort of smash them up against each other, sort of let them fight it out almost.
Yeah.
And try to touch on some like darker things as well within ourselves. And I mean, you all included, just like being, we all put so much shit out there, like you were saying, but there is like a weird, like
there's a
narcissism.
You know, well,
and,
obviously, but I mean, like I literally have my last name tattooed on my arm. Like, I mean, I'm the biggest narcissist, and like as we started writing the movie, we realized it was about more, it was really ultimately about like how we're none of us are actually listening. Like we're documenting every moment and every facet of our lives. Precisely. And like, I mean, like I'm taking a selfie right now, but like, am I actually listening to anything anyone in here is saying? God, no.
Yeah.
But like, I'm going to tweet that I was here.
Honestly, like as the hostess, that's all I really care about.
Right, exactly. So like, it's like this thing. So like what happens in, you know, an elevated version of that with all these like very needy, desperate creative types where one of them all of a sudden does have a serial killer in their midst. How long would it actually take you to like think people aren't just being like funny and sassy and ironic?
Well, and genuinely, to say seriously, I actually found that point, that aspect of it and that point of it sort of convicting and also brilliantly insightful, particularly about the group of people that you work with and all of us that live at this weird level between like gayness and like not enough known, and that element of needing to
create, because we're gay.
Well, and that element of needing to create your own work that then you have to publicize, that then you have to share about, that then you need to be doing interesting enough stuff in between so that your fans and friends and followers don't feel like it's always just shameless self-promotion.
100%.
And is there any time left to listen to the other side of the conversation?
Is there? I don't know. I don't listen to other conversations. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, really, it's really overwhelming. And I think, you know, it's interesting. It's hard to describe it. And I think our movie is an attempt at trying to describe that weird kind of life.
And when we read reviews that are like really get it, they say it so much more eloquently than we can say it.
You're right.
Well, like, in fairness.
Like, that's it. That's it.
In fairness, that's a critic's job to articulate that better. Yeah, you just tell the story and they get to, you know, summarize it for you.
But what I think, though, what is interesting is like in our group of friends, we all know each other. It's like one of those LA, I don't know if it's an LA thing or if it's an artist thing, but it's like, oh, so-and-so has a show this night. So-and-so is performing here. So-and-so. It's like there's always this constant like, you know, like I don't even know how to describe it.
I also really want to applaud you, particularly though, this group of people that you work with. One, they're all brilliantly talented and hysterically funny, with also the ability to turn on a dime and do drama really well, which you pulled out of everyone in this cast. And a lot of them, we don't get to see that side of them as much. And I love that. But also that you've worked so hard to build a group of people that are openly and loudly gay, that are also genuinely intelligent and thoughtful, and said, screw it, if people aren't going to make the work that's exciting for us to do, we're going to make it ourselves.
Well, that's very nice. I like that.
And there's not a lot of movies where you have sort of like, this is definitely a group of friends, and they're not, and like if you were to go to audition for a role, like all these guys would be up against
in
each
the same
other.
Room.
Oh, we are.
Right. And so like, this is our chance to be like, no, let's put them all together and see how different they are, even though that you might normally pigeonhole them all as the exact same part.
Right. Like they're all sassy waiters.
Yeah.
Like
shrieking,
what's ultimately happening underneath that.
A good sassy waiter.
But and I think I think it's cool to get to see people who you do kind of only get to see play like the funny friend most of the time get to like do something very different and also versions of themselves. Let's be honest. Mm-hmm. Like this movie is definitely written for each of these people. So we're writing to their strengths.
Well, and of course, then you know the men can write in voices that they inhabit well. But I genuinely love how much it presents a new idea in specifically gay filmmaking. I get frustrated with people that complain about gay filmmaking because I don't think there's any more bad gay films than there are bad regular films.
But I don't know about that.
Well, there is the Wishmakers of West Hollywood.
Starring Justin Martindale. Yeah, they're available on Netflix.
Is that a real movie?
It tastes like ass. Yeah.
Like it's literally called The Wishmakers
of West Hollywood.
Is it about kids dying with cancer?
No, they throw pennies in a fountain.
Yeah, and make
wishes.
Yeah. Yeah. Just ignore it.
I'm absolutely watching that. Yeah. Nice.
Me and Drew Drogi have a really great scene in it, I think.
But this, well, there you
oh,
go.
Yeah, oh, yeah, look at it. Just, get into it. Get into the film.
Into it.
I'm giving you film.
I've been seeing that popping up now and again.
Where? At the
No, like with
oh, in Netflix?
Things,
oh.
I think because Drew maybe is connected, so I'm
I love
seeing
it.
That.
I love that kind of thing. But you're right. Yeah, there are terrible movies no matter the genre, no matter like what whether it's horror, whether it's gay, indie, whether it's comedy, whatever. I complain though because I feel like sometimes like we just sort of go for like the most basic like shirtless guys like making out kind of thing.
Instagram models.
Yeah.
I mean, I just want to be them, so...
Well, that's my issue. Yeah. I get pissed off.
Wait, let's talk about something, because you're both smart, and genuinely, because there is a weird line, let's be honest, between the element of, like, being annoyed by somebody that has 500,000 Instagram followers because their body looks like a body that, like, none of us will ever have, even if we worked on it all day, every day, and being like, why does someone that's brilliantly talented that, you know, has a Instagram that's basically a love letter to Dana Delaney not have the same following? Because weird, you should.
Well, I think we just explained why, but, unfortunately. But, I mean, most of that comes from jealousy for me because, like, but it also comes from jealousy on a larger issue that, like, goes back to these people that we made this movie with. Of like, there are so many people in this movie that you're like, how is Drew Drogi not the most important person in all of like television comedy?
Right. Right.
How is Brian Salvi not like hosting the Tonight Show? Like,
yes.
It's so frustrating. And then you see, you know, certain people who are these sort of like gay niche celebrities that are so built up and so put on a pedestal that they have so many more opportunities than people who might deserve them more.
And you're like, aren't you missing talent?
And then I get pissy. But then ultimately it all just comes from jealousy. But ultimately that's all anything comes from for me.
But it is a funny dichotomy because I genuinely in my like personal journey, I have been working on trying to separate what's my like resentment of our community's response to certain people's presentation and what is their presentation. Do you know, it's like there's some people, like I can't begrudge that like what you do is you're a trainer and so your photos and your Speedo look amazing, but I'm on my summer of like, I don't give a fuck. And good so like you. Suddenly I'm like my skinny, you can play the xylophone on my ribs and I'm gonna post those photos and if you don't like them, stop following.
Yeah, I'm gonna give you praying mantis realness all summer long. just the body
good for you.
Of some
really
mantis.
Good for you.
I don't care. I'm at that point.
What do you have? What are you working on now, Jim?
We wrote another script together.
Of course you did, because what do you do on a Tuesday but write a whole other movie?
Right?
Exhausting these two.
This was something we wrote, like, with the idea of, like, not making it ourselves because it's written for teenagers and we don't know any teenagers.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about.
At least not officially.
My bangs are cheaper than Botox. Yeah. I'm totally an ABC family, like, college professor, but, like, a CW teenager. It's fine.
What's the CW?
Yeah. I feel like this is... So we wrote this thing, but we wrote that sort of on spec and are trying to figure out what to do with that next. Mm-hmm. If anybody wants to pay for that, they can.
Perfect.
And then we've sort of written a couple things. We're writing the short, but that's sort of been put on the back burner because we ran out of time.
Yeah, we have lots of little ideas. We're like, we have to make this short with wigs right now. And it's like, well, what for? And I don't know. You know, I think having a movie, which is something where people get to see it, and now it's hard to be like, well, are we going to make our little video or wig skit now? Like,
right. Who's available at 2 o'clock this afternoon because we've got a camera, so let's do it.
I was like, I'm available.
Yeah. I will say, and I wrote it down so that I could say it, my favorite line of the entire movie was, I don't know what it is about wigs, but they make me feel alive.
They make me feel alive.
Because I was like, I feel like that's the truth of like 80% of the people we know in common.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, I don't know you guys, but I have this wig, so let's create something around
let's
it.
Let's do it.
I'm wearing a lace front right now.
It's a good one, too.
See, I wear a shake and go, which is why I need the bangs.
Yeah, he's got a hard front
like the lace
there.
Front. This is like a $9.95 7-Eleven wig.
And yours are extensions, I'm assuming.
Yeah. This is all sewn in. Yeah, this is a weave, actually, a really really.
A weave, yeah.
Jim, I do want to talk about the juxtaposition because it does seem like you do the jack of all trades. It's like, oh, okay, I can do all of it, but also supervise somebody else doing it, but I know how to do that. Because did you start in costume design? Did you start in the world of costume?
No, I started off, I mean, this the true story is like growing up, I always knew I wanted to work on TV. I didn't know what, but I was obsessed with Facts of Life. And
of course.
I thought, well, that shoots at
Mindy
NBC.
Cone, that explains.
Burbank, yes. Yeah. And, you know, and then when I kind of came out here, I didn't know what I was going to do. I did art department for a long time, and then I did costumes, and I've kind of done all that stuff.
Yeah.
Now I do costume supervisor on Last Man Standing, which is a sitcom.
Just a tiny little show. That
I've done,
a network television
that,
show.
I've done that for like 15 years more.
That's Tim Allen's show, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I've done lots
of... You just
of,
sort of bounce around to different sitcoms
Yeah,
now
and you know what?
That.
I love it because here's the hard part is that if you, like, doing the stuff that we do, I don't really... I kind of want to do my own thing. I don't really, and with working jobs on costumes, I can, it's not like the craziest schedule in the world. Like we get hiatuses and there's lots of time.
But you're not worrying about having to do a stupid gig at like,
Are
you really?
No, but but it's my backup. No lie.
You'll be seeing
I am
a lot
qualified as a task rabbit tasker. I haven't
Are
done
you?
It yet,
oh,
but
yeah?
that's my backup.
I mean, I think that's why I love it. Like having like, I'm also sort of trying to be like, happiness. Like, what's a happy life that I can do and then also do my creative things and not require this movie to solve every problem I have?
Right, financially.
Because
you
know? It's not going to... But I wanted to do something fun.
I'm in the opposite position. Where, where I don't think I've ever had a real job and like it's awful.
I just wake up and flip a coin and see what happens.
But you also have a genius way with words that you're like, I don't know, I was like free for a moment so I wrote a book.
Yeah.
And which
that's
is amazing.
What I should plug. It comes out, Drag Teen, it comes out April 26th and you can pre-order it now anywhere books are sold. And the audiobook
amazing.
Comes out a few weeks after that, which is with me.
And genuinely check it out because I'm not saying this just because he's sitting here, but I obviously should say it since he's sitting here, that Jeffery is one of the funniest people that I follow across social media
Well, Jeffery and myself were two of the 16 funniest people in Front News magazine.
So there you go.
In West Hollywood, look out.
Watch out.
Because there's 16 of us.
I bet I could get a free drink at Rage.
No one can get a free drink
hour.
At Rage.
Maybe at Happy Hour.
No one.
But genuinely, I love what you are doing. And because I do think there's this element of how do we get, because I'm a huge fan of people that are openly gay and that it informs their work, but it's not the point of their work.
Right.
Which is, I think, what you achieved really well in this movie, that it is a rom-com where, and I hate the phrase, like, just happen to be gay, because that's equally insulting to me. But like, the story is brilliant on its own.
But they just happen to be gay.
And their sexuality informs their perspective and humor. Right. So it is specifically gay, but it is not about being gay.
Well, that's what I was in Atlanta this weekend and did some shows there. And there was like these young kids who were like, thank you so much for doing what you're doing. And I was like, what? Because here in LA, you're just like, I'm just tired, you know. I just, but like these, you know, there's these young audience members who were just like so grateful for being like, thank you for being there, and that was kind of like inspiring to be like, oh wow, all right, well you're welcome.
Well, because my personal soapbox on the issue is, I think as a community, as gay men, we have we face a challenge on a regular basis. I'm curious to see what you think, that we are happy and thrilled to welcome people who are already celebrities who come out because we can claim them.
Right.
But we have a really hard time building our own stars.
100%.
Who are openly out from the beginning. Because I agree, there is no reason that your comedy group should not be one of the most successful shows on one of the platforms.
Right.
And that Brian shouldn't be hosting a Tonight Show type style. That continuing to do the work that you are doing in our community, we've got to look around and be able to say, let's support the people that are creating work specifically about us. Mm-hmm. By our best and brightest.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and I think that's changing very slowly, very, 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 very slowly. But it's so infuriating. That drives me crazy that you like look at like some of the main gay magazines out there and it's like they always have like either a straight celebrity on the cover or like a straight celebrity who might be gay.
Or a thirst trap. Like, here's someone in their underwear.
Well,
what's happening?
And genuinely, you articulated it perfectly in the movie when he gets to the point where he says, can we stop the bitchy gay for a moment and have a real thing?
Right.
Because that defense mechanism that is why so many gay men are great comedians, that pain of adolescence.
Yeah, absolutely.
But at some point, knowing when it stops being funny and when it's just tearing down the people that could be celebrating.
And yourself.
Right.
Right.
I mean, I do that in the mirror every morning.
Well,
like, you're horrible.
There's a whole hour of that.
Like, what is this weird lesbian Prince Valiant thing that you are sticking with? It's terrifying. So, wait, where are we time-wise, John? Oh my gosh.
2 minutes.
We have one more hour, so.
So thank you for being here.
You're welcome.
But genuinely, it is a wonderful film. It is
a great entree
into an unusual category within our LGBT specific programming. It was hugely successful on the festival circuits.
Did you say successful?
He did.
Sometimes I rely on pretty.
Which I like that term. Yeah.
I rely on pretty.
I saw a tweet to you about it that I thought summed it up really well. Somebody said, "This was the tone that I wish Scream Queens had gotten all the way
right,
to."
Right.
I was like, that is so true. Yeah. Like, that was such a great tone.
Why aren't you writing Scream Queens?
Yeah,
it's like,
seriously.
Why aren't you writing that show?
I would like to write on that show. But thank you so much for having us. This is so. I'm such a fan of you guys. Truly, I enjoy you guys on People's Couch so much. And Justin, I don't mean you because you're not on that show. But
I know that's part of my frustration.
He's the Faye Resnick of the People's Couch.
I'm the Faye Resnick. Yes, we've come to terms with that.
That's so true.
You genuinely.
So sad. Does that make Scott Nevins the Nicole Smith Brown?
But alive.
But alive.
Yeah. But alive.
I mean, he's probably the Kim Richards.
Scott is.
And Blake's the Lisa Vanderpump, and I'm the Brandy Glanton.
Like, that's more of a Kyle.
Yes, he absolutely is a Kyle, but he's definitely Lisa, and I'm definitely Brandy. Uh-huh. That's our truth.
That's really funny.
And Julie's Nene.
just out there. Wait, so where in the social media world can people find you? At Jeffery Self, but everywhere.
It's Jeffery, Jeffery Self. A lot of people, Will and Belly specifically, always misspell it, and then I get pissed because they have a lot of followers,
right,
and then I don't get those followers that they tweet it at. Not that I like worry about that kind of thing.
No.
Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Snapchat. And I'm on Snapchat.
You don't really do the social media, but you can see a lot of your stuff directly at the website.
Yeah, on YouTube, the Orphans.
And your website is Jim Hansen.
JimHansenFilms.com.
And Paragon School for Girls has its own website as well.
Yes.
So
and you can access it kind of through Jim Hansen.
So basically, if you want to find Jim, you look for the work first. It's those of us that are trying to be out front that have to whore ourselves across the social media. Justin Martindale, did you enjoy your first adventure?
I had so much fun.
Okay, thanks. Blake.
Can I promote some things? I will be in Nashville, Tennessee at Zanies Comedy Club March 18th through the 20th, and then Cincinnati, Ohio, April 8th through the 10th.
And you know where to find me and Blake. This episode was sponsored today by Wolfe Videos.
Oh.
Brand new, stunning independent film, You're Killing Me. Thank you guys so much
Thanks
for joining
so much
us.
For having
you check it out on iTunes. It is available on Vimeo. You can rent it for 48 hours. You can download the whole thing and save it forever. And if you're old school and you need the DVD, go to wolfevideo.com. Thank you so much for listening, you guys. We'll be back next week with Del Shores. Bye.
Bye.
Yay. Now that you've found UBN Radio and discovered our quality talk shows, it's time to spread the word to friends, family, and the universe. 24 hours of music and talk. Radio without limits. That's why people keep coming back for more. That's UBN Radio.